So, hello, I'm Janus Keller, and this is Out of the Blue, a podcast about what happens within the TU Delft. And today we are in the main hall of the Faculty of Industrial Design Engineering, and we're talking to Vroukje Sleeswijk-Visser, and she is best known as Context Queen.
Yeah.
So, what is that name? So where did that come from?
Because I coined the term context mapping.
Aha. So we'll get into that later. Yeah. But then there's this other part which is called queen.
Yeah.
So why are you the queen?
Well, what do you think?
Yeah, because you're royalty. No, so as I know from playing theater, you cannot play the queen, you have to be it. So that means that other people see you as the queen of context mapping.
Yeah.
And so how does that feel?
Terrible. Terrible. When I had to choose the name, I had to go to the Chamber of Commerce to find a name. And I just was doing a project, so I didn't have time to think about a branding or anything. It was clear that it was just me, it was not a company. And then I was just playing with the idea of context queen. It had to be context. Context mapping was too broad.
Yeah.
So I just came with the name, but my mother really, really, really said that I couldn't do that. That it was too arrogant to coin this name. And I must say, I think I still made a good choice because people recognize the name. And they kind of like it, or they find it funny, or maybe they find it really stupid, but they don't tell me then. But it works. Somehow it works, so I just leave it.
Good. So now we have to get to that context part itself. So you graduated here at TU Delft Industrial Design Engineering as well?
Yeah, it's particular to say I never left the building.
You never left the building?
I never left the building. And I did my studies. I did a PhD. I didn't plan to do a PhD, but I just wanted to do 1 year and I stayed. Actually, I didn't want to do my studies here, but I started and I ended it. I didn't know what else to do.
Yeah.
I did a PhD and then I took a part-time position as an assistant professor.
Yeah.
And I think I'm really, really proud of this faculty. I really don't want to go away here. I really like this faculty. And I think I also want to stay here in the next year. So I never expected that beforehand.
This is one of the things you might have criticized in your teachers when you were studying here, and you are now one of them, maybe.
Yeah, unbelievable. Really unbelievable.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine. It's so comfortable here. So when you graduated, was that also in this field of context mapping, or?
Yeah. Yes, the whole thing was in a little background. When I was doing my studies, it was not in this building.
Okay.
Yeah, it was in still the different buildings in the different places. And it was much more separated. So something was in the building there, something was in the building there. There was not really this community of industrial design together.
Yeah. Especially not research, maybe.
Definitely not research. Not at all, I think. Or not familiar to me as a student. And I remember in one of the design courses, it was called Ontwerpen 3 in that time.
Yeah.
You had to develop a concept for something. And then I wanted to do user research. We had to make a lifestyle collage. Yeah. And I remember that I told my coach, okay, if it was about skaters who were in the skate park, can I go out and I want to make photos of those skaters? And that was not allowed. I just had to make a collage about their lifestyle. And I said, well, I want to know how they deal with music, because it was about music. Music when you're skating. Does one play the music? Do they play music together? Don't they play music? What would be the position for a radio in such a place? And he thought it a bit, it was awkward. And I thought that it really made me mad, because we are designing products for these people and we are not really meeting them. So I just did it. And I loved it, and I got a really good grade in the end.
So the teacher was also convinced that you did a good job.
He did. I wanted to have an evaluation talk with him about this. He didn't want that.
Okay.
But that made me think. That made me realize this is what I like about designing.
Yeah.
Knowing more about people, and how things fit people in their everyday lives.
Yes.
That's really what I liked. So then I was searching for a graduation project where I could bring that interest further.
And that was?
And that was a graduation project with a usability company who did testing of concepts, of product concepts. And they had a question to, can you also involve users before there is a concept?
Ah.
Open question. And that was my graduation project. And the answer was context mapping.
So that was already the answer. So did you call it that?
I called it that way, yeah.
And so can you tell me, so now the audience is probably quite curious, what is this context mapping that you're talking about? So if you're not a sort of a designer in this building, how would you describe context mapping in sort of a rough way?
In a very rough way, it's really looking to how people use products and services in their everyday lives.
Yeah.
And bringing that everyday context to the design table.
Yes.
Instead of a very quantitative study or a study about the branding where a product or service is really in a vacuum. It's really the everyday life of people.
So the everyday life of people. And that is actually the title of your PhD.
Yes.
What is it? Bringing the everyday life of people into design.
Yes.
And what was the, how did that work? So how did it become, you were already done when you graduated, or was there more after that?
When I graduated, it was in 2003, and in that year, the faculty changed from the structure we had to a bachelor master structure.
Yeah.
And there was a new master, or actually all the three masters were new, but two were already, that directions were there, but the master DFI didn't exist. That was new that year, and it had to be filled. And Pieter Jan Stappers, my professor, had a new course, context conceptualization,
yeah,
and he needed material for this course. And my graduation project perfectly fitted in there. So then I started teaching. And then I started the PhD about it.
Oh, so you first started teaching,
yeah,
at the Design for Interaction Master?
Yeah.
And then?
To develop that method much further, because we just did the beginning.
Yeah.
It was just a graduation project. It was not so much yet.
So there was basically a course based on a graduation project.
All in the beginning it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The term context mapping is typically a Delft thing, but it's part of sort of the whole approach of participatory design, right?
Yeah. Involving users, working with users when you're designing something that they will use.
Yeah. And what is the idea behind? So what is the main idea behind that? So why would you involve people in the design process?
Ah, that's a good question, huh?
Yeah.
I think in essence design is really, there's a lot of types of design, huh? We have a lot of different types of design, from fashion to graphics to system design to designing for policies.
Yeah.
Design is everything, but in industrial design we are designing products, services for people.
Yeah.
So, and we are at the TU Delft.
Yeah.
TU Delft is about technology.
Yeah.
And design is, I think, making the technology usable, useful for people.
Yeah.
Instead of that people can use the technology.
Yeah.
The technology should be used by people in a way that they want to live their everyday,
yeah,
lives.
Yeah.
So having a very close relationship with the people that you're designing for, the solution you're making, they should be part of your design process.
Yeah. Well, that's logical. Then again, sort of the everyday life of people, if you look at reality TV, if it was unedited, it would be extremely boring, right? And is the everyday life of people, isn't that boring? Or
that's the funny thing. Not every designer likes context mapping that much, but someone like me, and there are others in this faculty, that I think unedited material of such a TV series,
yeah,
is really interesting.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, I never get enough of watching people and seeing how they do things and how they communicate and what they talk about. My interest doesn't stop.
So basically, you never sort of say it about a user and a product, this is boring.
No, never.
Never.
Never, no. No. No, I really like it.
Yeah. Yeah, so the everyday people is always exciting. And yes. Where do you find that excitement?
I just really like how people do things and see things. And context mapping is also about the people themselves, huh? The individual or the small family or how they use things in their own time. And just knowing and seeing more about how people live their lives.
Yeah.
Is the most direct way of seeing what human beings are.
Yeah.
How do you behave? It's different from reading a book or seeing an edited piece of video. That's different. So the raw data is something that I really, really like.
Yeah.
And I find it also sometimes difficult in these context mapping projects, in consulting, to downsize it.
Because you want to tell everything.
Because if it was up to me, I would like to just spend hours on it and show everything.
Yeah, so and your audience needs editing, right? So they don't want the raw data.
And that's coming back to your question about the PhD. That was actually my question in a PhD. So this context mapping method seems to work, does interesting things, brings raw data, everyday life fragments of people to the design table.
Yeah.
But companies that are commercial companies that want to bring in user involvement, they can't work with raw data.
Yeah.
They need actionable results.
Yeah.
And that was my PhD question. So how can we communicate this type of rich data in a way that could be used in commercial practice?
Yeah, yeah. How is that currently working?
It's still working a lot like that,
yeah.
Because companies are big companies and they just have different teams, so they can't do everything themselves. But in smaller companies, it's really merged.
Yeah.
And then you have these new kind of professions like service designers.
Yeah.
They're a bit in between. Or startup companies where they do everything themselves, and there it's really blended.
Yeah. And does that make it better, or does it make it sort of different, or do they have the same problem, sort of that raw and edited data is too much, makes it inactionable, or?
No, I think actually it's better if it's more merged, if they do it, because then you don't have to communicate it and throw it over the wall to another team who has to work with it.
Yeah.
So yeah, and moreover, it's also not a research approach to, it's not like anthropology where you just explore everything in all its richness just to describe the setting as it is. Yeah, we are designers here, so you can just pick what you think is interesting.
Yeah.
And that's what you use for your design. And smaller teams like in startups or like service design teams, they are able to do that. They can just use the research, pick what's interesting, develop in a first prototype, or come with some ideas, test it again. And I think actually, maybe that's better. Because in a big company where there are no service designers, it's still too much of the meaning of a insights are lost.
Yeah. They sort of have a hunch, but not the real experience.
Yes.
In there.
Yeah.
Because you said a designer can pick what they need. Is that what they should do, or?
Yes, that's what they should do. I don't think it's necessarily. It should be scientific. It should not be scientific.
Okay.
It should be. Like honest and bringing in different perspectives, and there should be like reflection on, are we here focusing on the right things? Are we not biased? And those things should be part of the analysis.
Yeah.
But it shouldn't be put in a rigorous method of analysis. And this is the data, and these are the insights. If you work that way, you lose the aspect of being inspired, what you find in those stories.
Nice. Because that actually brings me back to your graduation, where your coach said you shouldn't use real photos, but sort of things from magazines. That is sort of, designers want idealized, and these photos are idealized versions of skaters, right? The ones in the magazine.
Yeah.
As the ones you were seeing in, you know, Rotterdam, for example, they were not idealized. They were falling and they were clumsy, maybe, or different. So So in that same way, if you use these collage materials, you're using sort of idealized materials. So if you're using sort of that real data, are you still making that idealized product, or are you making a realistic product, or what? So does that change the design result?
I think it does. On one hand, but there's one other thing that you, what triggers me is, for example, this skater project.
Yeah.
I have an idea what skaters look like and what they like and how they listen to music. I'm not a skater.
No.
I had some friends who were skaters. That's all.
Yeah.
So it's my, and there we maybe become a bit in a scientific mode. If I have to design for these people, I use my presumptions about these people. Who am I as a designer to think what I know, that I can design something for them? So I need them to learn from them to know what's important and how they behave. It's a bit the designer there who chooses then what he picks for his creative process.
Yeah, what he is inspired by, as you said. So that makes it what is actionable in some way, right?
Yes, what's actionable, yeah.
What can you do something with?
And something else, in one of the consulting projects I did a few years ago, I was working for a pharmaceutical company.
Yeah.
And they hired me to literally study the people who had that disease and study them in their everyday lives. Literally, that was the main question. They paid me for that. When I came back with results and videos and stuff, they were really, really like, of course, it was about the insights. I'm not going to talk about the whole process. But one of the comments that I got quite often was that they said, how were you able to get so close to them? Ah. To get so close on their skin, and that they dare to tell you so much things. And their houses, the interiors, it's so rotzooierig.
Messy, yeah.
So messy, and you... How was it possible that you got there? And I really thought like, but you asked me for this assignment to get into those lives and to bring that back to the design table of your company. So why are they so surprised that I...
But they were happy with it, right?
They were really happy, but that I showed them the real life. But they expected that the houses would look more like the interiors that you see in the magazines.
Yeah.
Like no mess around.
Yeah, sort of idealized versions of happy elderly people with medicine.
Yeah, and the real life, the everyday life is different. I mean, things are happening differently.
Yeah.
Or more realistic and more recognizable to most people, at least.
And that generates a lot of noise, right? So there's a lot of sort of things happening in the background. Isn't that hard for a designer?
No, it's only inspiring. The more you see, the better it is.
Okay, let's get it on.
Yeah.
All right, so actually your most cited publication is called Context Mapping Experiences from Practice, and you did it with Remco van der Lucht and Pieter-Jan Stappers.
Yeah.
Do you know why it's so popular? So what sort of, what made it work for the audience?
Well, I think it's a sign of a time. In that time, user interest, attention to the user was growing.
Yeah.
But we didn't have much clear methods yet.
No.
There was culture probes, sending out packages to people where they filled in with whatever information comes from them.
Yeah.
And then you analyze it without speaking to the people who filled that package. To be inspired, you had interviews, you had observation studies, you had all kind of different things, but everything was a bit scattered.
Yeah.
And context mapping, I think, brought it a bit together. And in that paper, we propose a very strict procedure, let's say, where if you do research with everyday people, you invite them on their... they are experts of their experience.
Ah, right. Actually, that was what I was hoping for that you would say at the beginning.
Yeah, but that's already a different role, because then they are not a respondent.
So the people you interview are the experts on their own experience.
Yes.
Yeah.
They can be the only ones who knows most about their own experiences.
Yeah.
And it has this procedure context mapping procedure starts with inviting them on their expertise of their own experiences. Then you invite them to prepare something in a playful way about these experiences. Quite often it's diaries or something they fill in their own time. And then you meet them for interviews or you do creative sessions together. And then you ask them to tell their stories based on the diaries. And you ask deeper and deeper, deeper questions in order to find out as much as possible.
Yeah, so a very layered approach. There's sort of lots of...
Yeah, and that gave a lot of grip, I think, to people who wanted to involve users more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you give a structure, people sort of use it as a... It is sort of a good way to...
To proceed through... Yeah, to involve users in that way.
Yeah.
The downside of that part is it doesn't have to be such a strict procedure, of course.
Yeah, so if you look at it now, how would you change sort of the paper now?
I think it's much more about the underlying principles or the mindset as a designer, how you work with users. So the fact that they are regarded as experts.
Yeah.
You as a designer, you are an expert on the design process.
Yeah.
They are an expert about the everyday experiences regarding that product or that service.
Yeah.
You're on an equal level. That's a principle.
Yeah.
The other principle is discuss the past before you discuss the future.
Yeah.
Because if people can rely on when I started skating, I still remember my first skateboard. It was like that. I got it from this older friend. You start realizing what's important to you.
Yeah.
And then you might say meaningful things on what a new product or a new prototype, what might be relevant for you.
Yeah.
So it's more the principles and the mindset than it's this exact procedure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so the paper context mapping also sort of relies heavily on the work of Liz Saunders.
Yes.
So. Sort of to sum it up, because you already sort of gave a little thing about sort of the past. So there's the past, present, future, and how does that?
That comes from Liz Saunders.
Yeah.
Yeah, Liz Saunders really has this. She was one of the great inspirations during my graduation project.
Oh, okay. Already then.
Yes. She comes with this. That you first have to go through the past before people can... They have to become aware of their own experiences.
Yes.
Because people are not aware of their everyday experiences.
And typically a cultural probe is a good way to become aware?
Yeah, but that's still very open. It doesn't direct you. And context mapping is a bit more directive. It really zooms in on a topic. So if it's about skating, it's much more like, why do you like it? When did you start it? How? When do you do it? How often do you do it? With who do you do it?
And that sounds like a regular interview, right?
Yes.
These questions.
But if you ask them, if I ask you now, I don't. Did you ever skate?
Yes. I hate it.
You hate it.
Well, no.
Yeah. Why?
Well, my parents love skating. In the age that I was 16, 17, so I was rebellious. So.
So you didn't want to do it because they did it.
Yeah, that's it. So very petty. So now I like it.
Now but you do it also now?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, well, maybe this is a bit simple answer, but if I do this interview now with you, and you're quite open and easy to talk, I know you talk easily, but some people need time to think what they think of something, what they feel about something, and for that you need like a probe or some sensitizing, because why is something important to me? Why do I like cycling in this way so much?
Yeah.
Is it the fresh weather? Is it because I get fast, because I have my freedom? People need some time to become aware of that. And that's exactly what Liz Saunders proposed in her earlier work before I graduated.
And what does that sort of, because I think a lot of the audience doesn't know what a probe is. So what roughly does that look like?
Like, it's a package with all kind of like funny exercises.
Yeah.
It could be, in the past it used to be a camera, now we have smartphones.
Yeah.
Or an audio recorder, or some phone number you have to call to, and some strange postcards.
Yeah.
Maybe a cake that you have to bake with certain ingredients. Like really crazy stuff that you just have to use and do. and you create your own stuff with it, and then it gets back to the design table. And the design table opens up these packages that are filled up with partial stories or things that they made of, and then you get your inspiration from it.
And why do they have to be so crazy and funny, and what is...
To spark imagination.
Oh, so, yeah. And for the user, but also for the designer, or...?
For the designer, mostly
for the designer.
Yes. But in context mapping, we have a bit more focused approach. So it's quite clear that the package is about skating.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have all these crazy little probes that you send out to the user's world and then get back. It's a bit more applied. It's a bit more direct. So in context mapping, it's not a cultural probe. It's much more like a little package with some directed assignments.
Yeah, so less crazy, yes, and a little bit more directed.
Focused on the topic.
Yeah, but still playful is important or not?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, it should be playful, because if it's like a questionnaire,
yeah,
people gonna respond to answer your questions.
Yeah.
If it's playful and a funny package to work with yourself, which is about your life and your experiences,
yeah,
then people feel free to add what comes up to them, yeah, what they like to talk about. And that's exactly what you want to know.
Yeah, so this brings me to, at some point I was part of a research that you were doing. You asked me, and then I said, well, I don't have good examples, but maybe my parents do. And I actually brought it with me. So this is a research that you talked to me about, sort of, can you please make a story about the router for the internet? And it's, so as you said, nothing is boring. Well, a router is extremely boring, isn't it?
Yes,
or not?
Yes. Well, I thought so too.
Yeah.
The product router that you have at the home,
yeah,
in your home, to,
and you,
to
you
receive
get it from your provider, and
yeah,
it's ugly or something, right?
When was this? 2000?
This is around, so around 10 years ago.
Yeah,
this is my 10-year challenge right now.
You are there with your parents.
Yeah, and I talked about, sort of, let me briefly, so here's a photo that I made of me with my parents, which is always fun to make. And then I showed my old house, my new house, because I was moving, but especially, and this is interesting, I made sort of photos of where the router is at. And this is extremely messy, right?
I still have this router now. Have this router now.
Yeah.
You too?
No.
No, you have a different one.
Yeah. No, I wish I had, but, and then sort of, so all the wires, it's basically a photo set of ugly wires, right?
It is, yes. It's yeah.
Was it more people came back with this?
Yes.
Yeah.
But also people put it in different places. So we, a bit background.
Yeah, what did you do with this, sort of, I made this, and what did you do with it?
So this was a question from the company who creates routers and does a lot of, like, teleconferences?
Video calling, stuff like that.
Yeah, all that technology, that's what they produce.
Yeah.
And one of the products they have is routers, and actually they had a new version of a router developed for consumers,
yeah,
and users in their homes.
Yeah.
So not for business settings. And they just wanted to know the color.
Oh, they only wanted to know the color.
It was a color validation study. So how can you do context mapping about the color validation study?
Yeah.
Well, as you know, I think you can always learn something from people in their homes. So let's use that as inspiration. And I never expected it, but they thought I proposed it. I was like, shall we not do a context mapping study? It's purely qualitative. We're not going to interview a lot of people, but I'm going to give some interesting insights
about
how people relate to routers. And from that insight, you can derive what colors might be interesting for the European market, because they had it on the American market.
Yeah.
And in that time, grayish purple, beige, brownish, light brownish.
Yeah.
Those were the colors in the US market. And they had a hinge?
Yeah, an idea, yeah.
An idea that in Europe it should be more bright colors.
Okay.
But they wanted to test that.
Yeah.
And somehow they thought it was, they they took the risk, like, let's do some context mapping and check that.
So then, with how many people, sort of roughly, I don't know if you still remember, but was it like 100 or 5 or?
Well, I think it was 8 people in the Netherlands and 8 people in the UK.
Yeah.
And then what we did is I did it together with Standby.
Yeah.
And a service design agency or design
in Amsterdam
agency.
And London, yeah.
Yeah, because they have that office there. And we found people in our own network, very low skill, yeah. Low level, easy. People who have routers and what, and we send them a PDF,
yeah.
With some assignments. That's the derived version of the probe. Or
yeah, very simple version, yeah.
Where do you keep your router? Can you make a photo? When did you buy it? Who uses it? What do you like about it? What do you don't like about it? Do you have anything with it? If it would be a pet, how would you use it?
Oh.
Who would it be?
Yeah.
Just
strange question. Yeah.
Strange questions, but just really like people are not aware of their routers. It's not for most people. It's not a very important product, but still, people make choices for their routers, especially if you don't get it with your internet provider.
Yeah.
If you choose it yourself, you make certain choices.
Yeah.
And some people hide it, and some people have it quite prominent because they want to access it quite often.
Yeah.
And actually, you learn a lot about that. And then we had these insights, we plotted them together, then we had this conference call because this company has...
Yeah, because they do eat your own dog food.
And actually, then the conclusions was it should be matte black.
Matte black, yeah.
Matte black. Yeah. Or shining white,
yeah. Because that glossy sort of white.
Yeah,
yeah.
Because that related to the more modern computer products that we were having in that time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that was it.
Yeah.
And they did.
And
it.
All the other insights that you found, all the stories about the cables. What happened to that?
Nothing.
Nothing. No.
Nothing. No, you still have it.
Yeah.
No, nothing. It was just, we didn't do much analysis. We did some one afternoon together, and then we had this conference call with the design team in the US, and then it was prioritized, and that was it.
Yeah, but they did see this sort of these materials and these insights, did
yes.
they? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
So that design agency sort of that did it also knows a little bit about all this.
Yes, we made summaries of the thing that you provided.
Yes, and others.
I think you made a diary.
Yeah,
PDF.
Yeah. One picture.
I think we took like 2 or 3 pictures and 3 of your what you wrote down about it.
Yeah.
And 3 fragments of text, and that's it.
Yeah, that's more than enough.
Yeah. And this is based on still, it's 16, but real-time stories.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
From real people, in their real houses, between the real other messy stuff they have there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's authentic.
Yeah, it's authentic, yeah.
And that's a different thing. And it's time-consuming, it definitely is. And I think still design teams have a difficulty selling context mapping-like processes when they have to design some solution.
Well, especially if it sort of slows things down, maybe. So if you have to wait for the results to be analyzed.
But it doesn't really have to be analyzed. You just make co-creation workshops from it, you know? Yeah. It's more...
So what is that? So co-creation workshops, what happens at these?
No, but still, I wanted to say something else about like startups. They really do things quick.
Yeah.
They're really good in it also, I think, some of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
They just have an idea, they have something, and they believe in it. If that those kind of people, there are enough of those publications also, they just ask 2 people to test their very first prototype, or not even a working prototype, but just discuss the idea. And that's actually all you need to do, just go out in the field. Don't start designing your own concept in your own desk.
Shell.
And work on it and work on it and work on it. But go out and check it with people.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean what they say, what people say, that is that what you have to make.
That's
a different sign. That's something different. Designers can still choose what they take from the field back into their new prototype or in their new design. Coming back to this router that needed a color.
Yeah.
That's such a practical, I think, almost end step of a whole product design.
Yeah.
Because the whole product is there, the form is made, it's just the color.
Yeah.
That in the end needs to be there. The packaging is already designed, so that's a finished thing.
Yeah.
And the solutions nowadays are much more product service systems,
yeah.
Services, organizations, or even how parts of society are being redesigned. Like how should a school behave in society of a small village? Those are questions that designers tackle more and more and more.
Yeah.
Then you really can't deny anymore that it's about the people.
No, then a collage doesn't work anymore, right?
A collage doesn't work anymore. So then it becomes much more natural to work with users and to involve them by learning, like, what's meaningful to them, what do they need to do there,
yeah.
in a school or in a city. So that's also making it much more, I think, valid for designers to involve users.
Yeah. And so that's the other thing. I know that governments do participatory design a lot, right? But sometimes it feels like it's just sort of making sure that that we involve the user as sort of a policy.
Without not really involving the user.
That's it, yeah.
Ticking the box,
yeah.
We did it. Yes, that's those, for example, when a municipality does this participation evening.
Yeah, yeah, and let's draw a road.
Yeah, and then they involve the neighborhoods, yeah. And they say, like, yeah, we want your opinion about it because you live in a neighborhood.
Yeah, yeah.
Please come to this evening.
Yeah.
And then just the most proactive citizens come.
Yeah. And they yell a bit.
And they yell a bit because they complain, because that's the place where they can connect with the municipality.
Have you ever been in those?
Sort of. A lot.
Yeah, but
as a user, but also as a
organizer.
Designer or organizer. And but to be honest, this is also really interesting. These evenings for a neighborhood, it's organized. Of course, the first hour is about complaints because it's a moment where you can really meet the people who are providing you the new road in your neighborhood.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're annoyed because there is no parking place or too many cars or your neighbors make too much noise or you want to complain because finally you reach them.
Yeah.
So that has to be there first, but you have to accept that as an organizer of such an evening.
Yeah.
You need to get that out and then you come to the moment, what does this neighborhood actually provide you beyond all these complaints?
Yeah.
And then you start talking.
Okay.
And
so there is value in it still, even though it's sort of,
yeah,
as an experience, it sometimes feels like a, yeah.
But that part, that opening up for what could be, that is something that designers can facilitate.
Oh, okay. Yeah, and that's what often doesn't and happen, right?
No, because it's just putting
the label.
Pleisters op de wond, what
yeah,
is that?
Sort of plastering the wounds. No, sort of, yeah. There are wounds and we have to fill them up. You have to sort of take care of them.
Yeah, and then they could also say back to the organization of the municipality, yeah, we've heard those people and yeah, they complained about this and this and this, but now we can proceed building this new road because they have been heard.
They have been heard.
But have been heard is something totally different of, shall we look what could be in this neighborhood? That's a whole different question. That's a whole different mindset.
Yeah, nice. Normally at the end of the podcast, we try to give the audience a nice tip, something that they can read, view, do, go out. So as a, let me start so that you sort of know what you can do. So my tip for the audience is, I have been playing a game last year, which actually became sort of game of the year, but it still stuck with me, and it's called GeoGora. By Annapurna Interactive, and it's a hand-drawn game that plays with perspective, sort of Escher-like, but not like a Escher-like in that it sort of doesn't fit, but more that it zooms out and it's about composition and it's about sort of using different materials. It is now available on PlayStation, Xbox, iOS, Android, and it's a really fascinating game. It costs money, of course, but...
What do you do with it?
Yeah, so it's... I really enjoy the fact that you can... So you zoom in, zoom out, and you get surprised by the game, by the route that you take. It's a puzzle game.
But does it show patterns or landscape?
No, it's a story you go through. So you have to collect sort of icons, and then you have to do that by zooming in, by putting things in place, by making things click. So it's a real puzzle, but you often get sort of, you really find you sometimes by moving around find things that you didn't expect, and then you get these really aha moments, which I really enjoyed. And it's fun to play with other people that are behind the same screen, so that doesn't make it a solitary thing. So people can say, try this. So it's really visual, there are no hidden buttons or things like that.
Can you give one example to give what's an aha moment?
Yeah, so, well, very much in the beginning, you're moving something around and then the door stays behind when you move it. So then you say, there's something behind this picture, so maybe I can put, there's a hole there that is the same, and then you put it on top and then it fits. So it's like the puzzle, hey, this fits. The same things you have in physical puzzles, you now have in a digital sort of interactive, zoomable way.
Wow.
Fascinating.
Wow.
Yeah, and I saw the designer, he's called Jason Roberts, talk about it, and he talked about the awkwardness of the tools of making this game, so hand-drawn and stuff, but that the awkwardness is actually good. So that is a nice, so our tools need to be awkward. So maybe that's sort of a thing that we talked about as well. So the inefficiency is good for creativity, for inspiration. And so do you have a tip?
Well, I don't have a game tip.
No.
I'm not into gaming. But I have a movie tip.
Oh, wow, nice.
It's a movie from 2003, 2004, so a while ago.
Yeah.
In the time that context mapping also got bigger. And it's a movie from a Scandinavian director.
Yeah.
I think Danish or Swedish, I'm not sure anymore. It's called Kitchen Stories.
Kitchen Stories.
And it's fantastic, it's fabulous. It's like it's a feel-good movie, I would say, actually. It's about right after the Second World War.
Yeah.
There was a group of researchers that was going to do ethnographic research, how people use kitchens.
Oh, wow.
But in a very formal way. And then this whole idea that you should really observe people in their natural context.
Yeah.
So there's this group of researchers, kind of like scientifically, with all their codes, how they should do things. And then they go to single men in rural areas in one of the Scandinavian countries.
Yes.
So the movie also starts with this car, where 10 cars, and in all those cars, there's a researcher going to one particular farm where one single man lives alone.
Yeah.
And then for days or even weeks, they're gonna observe how that kitchen is used by that single man.
Yeah.
And it's really funny. They put this high chair up in the
like a tennis referee chair?
Tennis referee, exactly.
Wow.
So those are also behind the cars. and then the absurdness starts, because then they are not allowed to intervene with the subject that they are researching.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, they are sitting there all the time. And this movie is about the relationship that develops between the researcher, the observer, that has to be the fly in the wall, and really tries to stick to the protocol. But meanwhile, these are two humans in a very small space.
Yes.
So it's on this thin line of being, trying to be objective while human beings are just subjective. And when is it objective? When is it subjective? And it's hilarious.
Oh, wow. Yeah, very nice.
And it's also a beautiful shot. It's really...
So the way you talk about it sort of makes me feel of a sort of a Wes Anderson long perspective movie.
Yes.
It's almost like a... the premise also sort of automatically says, this goes wrong, right? It's sort of, things go wrong.
Well, one of the things that happened a bit, I'm not going to talk about, it's not really like a whole plot, but at some moment, it's really difficult to stay this fly on the wall type, yeah. Because he just sees that person there and he's also a lonely man, so they're just together.
Yeah.
And they're both lonely actually,
yeah.
Sitting there all the time. At some moment the researcher gets ill,
yeah.
Starts coughing more and more and more, and then the guy in the kitchen that lives there starts helping that guy.
Yeah.
So. And then you cross the borders, and then there's the director of the research group that sees that this
is happening.
One researcher is more and more getting involved and tries to call him back with all the protocols of research,
yeah.
How to observe people. So it's really, really, really interesting.
So it is basically a criticism of this kind of research in some way, but in a lovely way.
In a lovely way.
In a loving, yeah.
Yeah, it's much more about how human beings are beautiful. I think that's what the movie is
about. If it all goes well, in 30 or 40 years, there will be these same kinds of movies about context mapping going wrong.
Yes.
Lovingly.
Indeed, if they follow the strict procedure too much.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Well, let's hope for that, because then we've reached what we tried. Yeah. So with that, I would like to end this show. I wanted to thank Gerardo Solisa of the New Media Center, and Mark the Cole of Communication IO. And if you have feedback, we are really interested, so send me an email. I'm a.i.keller@tudelft.nl, and you can find Fraukje as a context queen by Googling it and finding more about her. So with that, thank you and goodbye.